I don't have to explain what I do or why, okay? These people that I photograph are my friends. When I was five, I always loved the underdog. I wanted to be a boxer, I wanted a monkey, and I liked the strangest wrestler. I'm fascinated by these people, okay? My father was thick gray hair, pinky ring, cigar, hat. It must come from that. And maybe the film noirs I watched when I was a child that had this stark lighting. So all of this combined goes up to make Bruce Gilden. Brooklyn, and then we moved to Queens. But I also started to educate myself art-wise when I was 17. I chose to go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and I'd go to look at the Impressionist paintings. So something was driving me, okay? And if I think about my life, I might be the last person somebody might have thought would be some type of artist or artist photographer, because I couldn't even draw a straight line with a ruler. And the reason I took up photography was, well, people say because of Blow Up, the movie by Antonioni, but that's just part of the reason. Because of that movie, photography was trendy. So in other words, it came before my eyes. So I said, hey, why don't I try photography? When I first picked up a camera, I didn't realize that what you saw is what you get. I mean, I was quite ignorant. And when I saw my first image come up in the tray of developer, I said, oh, I did that? It was the first time I really had done anything for myself except play sports. And I was impressed, you know, that I was able to do that. It wasn't anything fantastic. It was just, for me, it was special. My first long personal essay was Coney Island. When I started photographing there in 1967, it was crowded, but not as crowded as it was in the 30s or 40s. And also, I liked the idea that I could walk around without talking to people and make photographs. I used to wear a long sleeve jacket and like army boots on the beach, so you could see me coming from 3 miles away. And it's quite warm, and I was on my knees taking this picture because I liked her bathing suit, which is like, looks like underwear. It's not really a typical bathing suit. And I took a few pictures of her, and someone came over and said, what is he taking a picture of? And she went, over there. And I was so lucky because that made the picture, otherwise it would have been terrible. Yeah, I mean, it's wonderful. So the street is a way, is a place where I can cool off. I can, you know, think my own thoughts and just walk around the block and not pay attention to anybody and just, I feel at home. Actually, I think I'm attracted to the streets to do photography because as a child, I played on the streets, okay? And I guess emotionally also, my home wasn't very interesting to me. In other words, I suffered emotionally, which I didn't realize till I got older. And I'm at home in the streets. When you work in the street, you can't think. You have to act and react. But there's been a lot of thought involved from things I've looked at and who I am. Look, when you photograph, you can only be who you are. I can't be someone else and someone else can't be me. Well, to me, look, my father was a tough guy, gangster. If I have something to say to you, I'm going to say it, all right? I'm very blunt. I don't want to be someone who hides his camera. You have to be sneaky to get what you want, okay? So I do it in a more confrontational way. But I think these people that, you know, they keep their camera under their coat, or they stand across the street and they take a picture. For me, I would get mad if someone did that to me.
Oh, you lose something?
I'm in your face. Sometimes I'm so close that people think I'm photographing someone behind them because they don't realize it's them. In a typical photograph that people do documentary style, I call it like a stage set photograph. In other words, you're looking at the subject, okay? In my pictures, the viewer is involved in the picture because I'm so close. And I think that's a different way of looking at things. I should say one thing. This is one of my favorite pictures. I find that if I call it fake mustache, because I think if you go to the guy's face, it may not even be real. It looks like nothing's real in this picture. He's got a wig, it looks like. He's got sunglasses, a fake mustache. I mean, I don't know who he's hiding from, but he didn't escape me. <laughs> 1992, it says. I think in that day I only took about 8 pictures. And I saw this lady, blind lady, come out of the store with this guy. And he was helping her because she's blind, obviously. And I call it the giant, even though all my pictures are untitled. But I make up little stories, so that's called the giant.
What's been the most difficult confrontation you've
seen? See, this is the kind of question I really don't want to answer, but wait. No. Let's start. Let me answer what you're asking me, okay? Because first of all, it's not how close you are, it's how you are. Okay, that's number one. For me, I can turn your argument around on the other side. If someone came in my face and took a picture, I'm cool with that, okay? But if you take a picture like from 100 feet away with a telephoto lens, that I don't like. I don't like sneaks, okay? I don't like it in life, I don't like it in photography. So there are some people once in a while they get mad, but I've seen them get mad at people who are 30 feet away and don't use flash. It's how you carry yourself. If you're comfortable and you have a good bedside manner and you know how to deal with people, it's okay. For example, when I was with Sergei, there was someone who found Sergei and he found some other people because I told him I wanted to do, you know, tough guys. So he said, I got one for you I think you really like, and it was Sergei. But the thing was that he would just hang around and do nothing. So we meet him about, he lives 70 kilometers from Yekaterinburg, and we meet him out at his, on the road or at his place, I don't remember. And we go to the club. What a club. Nobody in there. It was Sergei and his friends that he brought. I said, this can't go on. You know, we have to do something. So what we wound up doing was that he organized his picnic.
The tattoo of the cat on his foot is a symbol for native prison dweller. But it also means be quiet as a cat so the cops don't hear you. Sergei, who's also known as the wild boar, he doesn't have to hit you twice, once is enough. And he says when he fights, the elephants puke. I see him getting mad at Vasily. And he pulled him out of the car with one hand, okay, and he threw him about 30 feet.
What can I do?
2 hours after, very drunk, he says, you have to leave. You know, he doesn't want any more pictures because God knows what he can do.
I also believe all the people I photograph are beautiful. They're beautiful to me. Not everybody has the same sense of beauty. I don't like the average looking person. I wouldn't be attracted to that. I've always felt I was on the margins. So why should it be any different in my work? For me, the margins are all where it happens. It's where the interesting things are. It's the middle I don't like. I don't like people that are in the middle in their life either. You know, it's not interesting for me. Ah, Japan. I spent like 4 trips, a little over a year there. Now this is my wife's favorite picture. I like it. It's a transvestite in Shinjuku, and that was just a candid shot. She was stopping for the light in the daytime. Go ahead. I love her lipstick. This is an area I like in Tokyo where some of the other pictures were taken and others will be. Asakusa. That's where you asked me about the Yakuza. That's a heavily laden, old-fashioned district with low-level Yakuza. That's Yakuza, okay? Go ahead. This is Bozozoko, which is in between Yakuza and God knows what. Those are the bicycle gangs. And I had an assignment to do that. And I was concerned because all these are 16, 17-year-old kids, and I thought they wouldn't be very formed. But to my surprise, they were very well formed. This is the, he's a pretty boy, but they have more pretty boys. This is the alcoholic, tough guy. I mean, they're formed at 17. It's amazing. I mean, you can see what their life is going to play out. So I went over their head. I told the guy I was going to go over his head to photo. And I said, that's the end. You know, they'll never let me photograph him again. Go ahead. That's the Yakuza from Ginza. That I can tell you for a fact, because I became friendly with them. They work together. They work in the Ginza area, which is a rich area. And the first time, this is the second time I saw him. He's like about 5'6". Tall, not tall, and 5'6" wide. Ex-boxer, martial arts expert. But I get along with these guys. We speak the same language. I'm comfortable, comfortable, comfortable. Okay, if I'm not comfortable, I don't do anything. He looks like he was from the 50s. What's the 50s? It's my childhood. We all want to go back to our childhood, all right? You know, black and white is the abstraction, okay? I see in the abstraction. I don't see in colors. For example, when sometimes I walk in the street with a color photographer in New York, he'll tell me, "Wow, Bruce, look at that red scarf." Or, "Look, she's got a, see the guy in the red shirt." I said, "What are you talking about?" Because to me, I see in black and white. I see in the abstract, okay? When I shoot in color, I look in color. So it's, you're seeing the reality, you're not seeing the abstract. And I think this is problematic for me because I like to go under the surface. I think people in my pictures are symbols for what I see. My photographs are about the society and the effect it has on the individual. There's a lot of people being taken advantage of. A lot of people in bad situations. And look, if you open up the newspapers, the world isn't a great place.